unto my bosom. Oh, yeah, the Lord said all these things. And we like to quote these things, but we don't want to go through the process. And all those scriptures are good and they're all true, but write this down. Only a diligent man will prosper. You got to be diligent in the good times, and you got to be diligent in the bad times. You got to learn how to be diligent in one way, and that will say this, in your giving. Consistent, steadfast, always in your giving. Here's the second thing you need to do. You need to be consistent and diligent in confessing the word. Speak the word of God over your life. When people speak ill and negativity, speak the word. A third way I would say that you need to be diligent is in your current level of finances is to pay your bills on time. Pay your bills on time. Don't go into debt for things that you don't have to have. We often compare ourselves to people and think, well, they got one, I need one. If they got it, I need one. I don't want to show up at the next family reunion and be still driving something 10 years old. Well, listen, honey, if it's paid for and it's running right, wisdom says you might want to reconsider going into debt for something. Can I get a smile from somebody? I have to learn how to wait and save. I remember when I first moved out on my own, I moved to Indiana, I moved in with Pastor Hill, Sister Hill, and they took me into their house and gave me a bedroom to sleep in, and I was so thankful for that. I saved up a little money and was able to go out and buy, rent me a place on my own, and I didn't have nothing. The only thing I had was everything that the church folk gave me, and they gave me everything that they didn't want. I got everybody. How many of you ever started off with somebody's leftovers? All of us. Somebody gave me something. You didn't get everything handed to you. They gave me a couch that had three legs on it. I had to make the fourth leg. It was a can of soup from Campbell's. I had no kitchen table. The legs on it were rusty. I had pots and pans and silverware. None of it matched, but it was mine. And I could cook a mean macaroni and cheese in an old used, scratched up pot. I could. Why? Everything I had to learn how to save. I had to learn how to put money aside. I had to learn how to be diligent in my savings plan. Oh, I know this is Holy Ghost anointing. You don't know it yet, but this is Holy Ghost anointing. Learn how to be diligent in your current level of finances. Pay your bills on time. Save and wait. Pay for cash if you can. Try to pay cash. Don't go into debt for stuff, for luxury items.
Amen.
Hence the word luxury. You know, people often expect the same pay as someone who's been working on the same job for 12 years longer than they have. Well, I don't know why they don't pay me my worth. I don't know why they don't take good care of me. Listen, length of service has to be taken into account. Well, you're going to get what you give. And if you give more, you're going to get more. You got to work hard. You see, people make statements like that. They don't consider character. Yeah, I would rather have somebody that maybe is as dumb as a bag of rocks, but they're smart in the way they love people. And they have a good heart, and they're willing to work hard. Amen. Listen, I want to understand something. People make statements and they want the same pay as someone who's worked longer than them, whether the individual is a higher or low maintenance employee, they don't take that into account. You see, if your employer is going to hire you, they don't have to always deal with you. You have to come to yourself where you just know what to do. And that comes with time. You see, sometimes people make that. They want to be paid more, but they're tardy all the time. They want to be paid more, but they're absent all the time. They call off every time somebody takes a trip to King's Island. They're calling off. I'm just saying. And so the spirit that we live in this world today is a give me spirit. Give me, give me, give me, give me, give me. I want this, I want that. Listen, I was raised in a house that taught me, my mom and dad taught me, that people have to start from the bottom and work their way up. I was taught that you have to say yes, sir, yes, ma'am. I was taught that you have to get up early, you couldn't lay in the bed. I remember my mom and dad had taught me that. And then after I moved out, when I said, I'm going to live on my own, I can't wait to get out of here, and I'm going to do my own. Make sure you know how to pay your bills when you're making those statements. And know that you're going to have to put food on your own table and buy you some insurance. Pay for your own gas before you're making those statements. And I remember laying up in the bed, Pastor Hill come knock on the door at 6 a.m., tell me half the day was already gone. Why was I still in the bed? I said, it's only 6 o'clock in the morning. He said, half the day is gone. I was taught you got to work your way up. And it was expected and actually enjoyed to do it. Because it was a sense of accomplishment and excellence in the work that you did for you and the people around you. That you put your heart into it and you had sweat into it. But at the end of the day, when it was all said and done, you can say, I did that. I accomplished that. And today we deal with people by the thousands who are dissatisfied. And I feel like that dissatisfaction spirit comes from the fact that people have lost the sight of the qualities that are really, really important in this life. Write this down if you will. The Bible said the soul of the diligent shall be fat. Now if you've been wanting to call somebody fat, if they're diligent, you can do it. Somebody said, Pastor Hull, what are you talking about? The soul of the diligent shall be fat. There's a guy in our church that's trying to put on muscle and he's trying to put on weight. Everybody else is trying to lose weight. This dude's trying to gain weight. I'm thinking, are you crazy? You're trying to put on weight, not trying to lose weight. Don't those people get on your nerves? I mean, they can eat a whole dozen adult Long's donuts and never gain a pound. And all you have to do is look at a Long's donut, 5 pounds. Belt's that. And you're thinking, are you serious? This guy's trying to put on weight. And so he's put it out there. He's telling everybody he's putting all this weight. So I walked up to him yesterday and said, how you doing, fatso? He's as skinny as a rat. But the word fat here, I want you to go to Proverbs chapter 13, verse 4, because he said, the soul of a sluggard desireth and has nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made fat. I read that and I thought, oh, that's about shouting ground right there. If God has created us to function, then a certain way that He has called us to function in, and we know what He's called us to do, then we're never satisfied on the inside unless we function that way. We have to learn how to flow with God. But remember what I said and write this down. Everything in life is a process. That is the way that God has arranged everything. Pregnancy is a process. Birth is a process. Growing up spiritually is a process. Growing up physically is a process. Education is a process. Learning is a process. And if that's a process, then why would promotion or advancement on the job or in your ministry be any different? Everything is a process. Write this down. The process is what makes the end result enjoyable. It's knowing that when I get to the end of it, it's all well. You see, grade school is a process. I couldn't wait to get out of sixth grade, Mrs. Beardsley's class. I couldn't wait to go to Ennis Junior High, Ennis Middle School. But middle school is a process. Oh, Lord, middle school's the worst. Those awkward years. Can I get a witness from somebody?
Hallelujah.
Then high school is a process. College is a process. And graduate school is a process. All of that. And you appreciate the degree you get after you work the work because you went through the process to get it. Nobody knows like you know how many buses you had to ride. Nobody knows how many dancers you had to avoid. Nobody knows how much mess you had to deal with in the hallway when people say your mama and they go kick your butt after school. Nobody knows what you went through but you. And when you get to the end and they hand you that diploma, you're about to have a fit because you know you went through the process. You can appreciate it. Because you went through the process. And isn't that what God does when He says He takes me from glory to glory? Here a little, there a little, day by day, doing it God's way. It's all a process. Go to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 through verse 15. I'm not going to read it all, but I want you to see the gist of this passage. The writer exhorts the people in diligence. And he tells them, he intends them to be diligent to remind them to be diligent. Now I'm going to say it again. He exhorts the people to be diligent, and then he says, I'm telling you this because I intend to be diligent in reminding you to be diligent. It's almost like somebody saying, would you give me a wake-up call at 5:30 in the morning? And you're thinking, I can't even get up myself at 5:30. So you have to call somebody else to call you so you can call them? You have to put a string around your finger to remind yourself to be diligent so you can call them and tell them what they ought to be doing? And this is what he's saying in essence here. He said, I want you to be diligent, and I intend to be diligent about reminding you to be diligent. And I want you to understand that's what your pastor's doing this morning. He's trying to tell you, don't just talk about it, be about it. Be diligent. Do what God has called you to do. And he tells them this in this passage of scripture. And so here, if ever we see a process, this is a process. So write this third point down, and that is this. There is diligence in ministry. We see it outlined to us about the diligence in ministry in the book of 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10, where he says this, and you've got to catch this. Give diligence to make your calling and your election sure. Give diligence to make your calling and your election sure, found in 2 Peter chapter 1 and in verse 10. But the amplified version of that scripture literally tells us that we are to be solicitous and eager to make our calling and election sure. And I read a lot from the King James, but I studied this also in the Amplified. And when he said be solicitous and eager to make your calling sure, this is what stood out to me, because solicitous means that you are concerned, that you are eager, that you are full of desire, that you are very careful, and that you are very meticulous. Well, the word meticulous stood out to me because of my melancholic nature myself, but meticulous means that you are paying attention to the details. And this is what the writer is saying. He's saying that some people want ministry, but they don't want to do the work of the ministry. There are people that want a title, but they don't want to do what's required to keep the title. He said, be solicitous and eager to make your calling election sure. If you say you're going to do this, then do it. If you say you're this, then be that. They want the attention, they want the respect, and they want the showy part, but they don't want the work that goes down. Are you? Now go with me to the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 28. We're really going to make somebody uncomfortable. In fact, look at your neighbor and say, Lucille, you're about to get uncomfortable. I have learned this in Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 8, and also in verse 12. He said, the Lord shall command the blessing upon thee and thy storehouses, and in all that thou settest your hand to do, and he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. The Lord shall open unto thee his good treasure, the heaven to give the rain unto the land in his season, and to bless all the work of thine hand, and thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. Here's what he was saying. He was saying, if you will be solicitous, if you will eagerly do what you have said that you want to do, he said, then here's what's going to happen. As a result of that, I'm going to cause rain to come upon your land. I'm going to cause blessing to overtake you. He said, I'm going to open to you my good treasure. Everybody knows in this room treasures are hidden. Ain't no treasure sitting down in the open. Everybody has it. You got to search for the treasure. You got to dig for the treasure. You got to mine for the treasure. You know how Beverly and I, we didn't just fall. I mean, people say they get married today because they're in love. You don't even know what love is until you've had a knockdown drag out. But don't get mad at me. Don't say, oh, no, Pastor, I don't agree with that. I'm just going to say, hold on. We thought we was in love. And we were in love. We loved the idea of being in love. And we loved one another. But our love became tested. And our love became the hardest when we went through the trials. And that's when our love was proven. That I wouldn't give up on her, and she wouldn't give up on me, irregardless of what circumstances were. That's when you really find out what love is. People say today, oh, we're just in love. I ask people, what are you in love? What do you want to get married for? We're in love, Pastor. I'm like, you ain't in love, you're in lust. That's what you are. You're not in love yet. You don't even know what. We're coming up on 24 years at the end of this month, and I want to thank God that we're still here.